gracious Lord, as we come before you this morning, we ask once again that you would enlighten our hearts and souls, bless our spirits, guide us according to your will, and lead us with the goodness that comes from you alone. We thank you, gracious Father, for the love that you have for us, and for the desire that you have to lift us up and to bless us. So keep us near to you, and enable us to understand the wonder of your love, so that we can share it boldly with others, as we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
To those who believe in his name, he has power to become the children of God,
and have promised them his Holy Spirit. He that believes and is baptized shall be saved. Grant this, Lord, unto us all. Amen. The introit for this morning is found in Psalm 2, verses 6 through 12. Would you read this responsibly? I have installed my king on Zion, my holy hill.
I am over my name to the decree of the Lord.
He said to me, you are my son. Today I have become your father.
Ask of me, and I will make the nations as your inheritance, the ends of the earth for your possession.
You will rule them with an iron scepter.
You will dash them to pieces like powder.
Therefore, you kings, be wise. Be warned, you rulers of the earth.
Serve the Lord with fear and rejoice with trembling.
Kiss the Son, lest you be angry, and you be destroyed in your way. For his wrath will flare up in a moment.
Blessed are all who take refuge in him.
Thank you.
sentence that begins with verse 8. One of the aspects that we have to grasp what was taking place was that for the first time in 430 years or more, the people of Israel were gathering, free, not being pursued, not in captivity, and were watching and seeing the presence of the true God. Because on the mount of God, there was this remarkable presence of God in a cloud. He had warned them that if anyone touched the mountain, they would fall over dead, because he was trying to impress upon them what the holiness of God meant, how different it was from the gods of Egypt. So Moses did what was pointing the people away from what they had been trained to what God now was trying to teach them about grace. He had a number of individuals bring before the people their oxen, and they slaughtered them, and he took half the blood, and in the presence of all the people, he had built an altar, and he poured half the blood over the altar, which symbolized the holiness of God in this place. Then he took the other basins that were full of blood, and I am so thankful we don't do this today. He walked out to the crowd, and as far as he could toss it, tossed it, and the blood went and splattered over the people. And the purpose of that was to demonstrate that forgiveness was something that was applied to them, not something they earned. It was given freely by God on their behalf. Now is the time when we start right after that, when Moses is explaining what is going to have to take place. It is a remarkable text about how God desired to bring grace to his people. It's just too bad so many times they seem to ignore. But anyhow, we will begin for a second. And Moses took the blood and threw it on the people and said, "Behold the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you in accordance with all these words." Then Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and the 70 elders of Israel went out, and they saw the God of Israel. There was under his feet, there was under his feet, as it were, a pavement of sapphire stone, like the very heaven of clearness. And he did not lay his hand on the chief men of the people of Israel. They beheld God, and even drank. The Lord said to Moses, "Come up to me on the mountain, and wait there, that I may give you the tablets of stone, the law and the commandment, which I have written for their instruction." So Moses rose with his assistant Joshua, and Moses went up into the mountain of God. And he said to the elders, "Wait here for us until we return to you. And behold, Aaron and Hur are with you. Whoever has a dispute, let him go to them." Then Moses went up on the mountain, and the cloud covered the mountain. And the glory of the Lord dwelt on Mount Sinai, and the cloud covered it 6 days. And on the seventh day, he called to Moses out of the midst of the cloud. Now the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a devouring fire on the top of the mountain in the sight of the people of Israel. Moses entered the cloud and went up on the mountain. And Moses was on the mountain 40 days and 40 nights. If this lesson is taken from 2 Peter, the first chapter, it begins with verse 16. Peter always references, and Peter always references to actual events that took place, and he was trying to impress upon the people this remarkable gift that God gave. And he always points them back to them, what we can trust in. And the one thing that it never changes, it will never change, it doesn't make a difference what people think, feel, try to maneuver, his word remains exactly what it is, which is God's. It's a transformation of a mind and heart. That's what God is trying to bring to us through Peter and explain to us in this text. It is a remarkable text for our time. "For we did not follow cleverly devised myths when we made known to you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but we were eyewitnesses of his majesty. For when he received honor and glory from God the Father, and the voice was borne to him by the majestic glory, 'This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased,' we ourselves heard his very voice borne from heaven, for we were with him on the holy mountain. And we have something more sure, the prophetic word, to which you will do well to pay attention, as to a lamp shining in a dark place, until the day dawns and the morning star rises in your hearts. Knowing this first of all, that no prophecy of Scripture comes from someone's own interpretation. For no prophecy was ever produced by the will of man, but men spoke from God as they were carried along by the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel for this morning is found in the 17th chapter of Matthew. We begin with verse 1. There are many texts in the scripture that humble us. Humble us as believers, humble us as individuals who study the scripture. This is one of them. There are many aspects of this text that God has not explained to us. There are many aspects that we do not grasp fully. Okay, grasp hardly at all. Yet the message of the text is one that is very bold and clear. It's showing us the reality of Christ being the Messiah, God-man, God in the presence of his people, in the revealing of his holiness. And yet, so much of this text is given to us so that we are just reminded, as much as we think we know very little. After 6 days, Jesus took with him Peter and James and John, his brother, and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them. And his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became white as light. And behold, there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. And Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good that we are here. If you wish, I will make 3 tents here, one for you, and one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He was still speaking when, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed him, and a voice from the cloud said, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell on their faces and were terrified. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Rise and have no fear." And when they lifted up their eyes, they saw no one but Jesus only. And as they were coming down the mountain, Jesus commanded them, "Tell no one the vision until the Son of Man is raised from the dead." Here ends the Holy Gospel. Would you please join me in confessing our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed at the back of the hymn. I believe God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven, and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you. heaven and earth very often. He has shown and reflected this a number of different times, when it was a vital aspect to carry on something that he needed the people to understand. When he spoke to Moses, he spoke from a cloud and came down, he spoke directly to Moses, and he spoke directly to the 70 elders. And it was all to impress upon them that this was a God who was alive, active, and he understood them. We had John the Baptist, a unique man, chosen by God, had one specific role, and that was to follow a path that the Lord had set out for him, which was to help the people understand who Jesus was, and that they had a purpose in life. It was to repent, and then he would cleanse them. John understood, was very competent, had been trained. He had a great deal of knowledge of the scripture. And yet, when he saw Jesus come, and Jesus came up to him and said, I need you to baptize me. John simply saw the reality of what was taking place. God's Lamb was in his presence. And John became overwhelmed and he stepped back and he said, Lord, I have need to be baptized by you. John was confronted with the holiness of the Lord. And it overwhelmed him. And Jesus said, John, I need to do this. I need to apply to baptism my spirit, my blessing, my strength, my reality. And so John did. And to implant into John's heart, and to implant into the people that were there, the Father spoke. This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. It was establishing at the beginning of Jesus' ministry. Jesus was more than a prophet. He was God in the midst of his people. He was both God and man. Now it's toward the end of his ministry. He chooses three disciples. Why did he choose these three? We don't know. But he chose them. They followed him up this mount. We don't know where the mount was. As they got to the top, and there was a minor separation between Jesus and the disciples, two people show up, Moses and Elijah. And they're talking with the Lord, they're conversing. Do we have any clue of what their conversation was? No. It's not given to us. There's only two people we know in the time that the Lord gave the promise of the Messiah in a direct way to his people. Only two individuals who we know from the scripture, their bodies did not decay. Elijah and Moses. Moses died, he was buried by God. The archangel Michael came down, took his body to heaven before it decayed. Why? Again, we don't know. But it just so happened that the only two people whose body ever came were now standing on the mount, talking to Jesus. Talking and discussing a father's desire for his son to be strengthened and encouraged and uplifted by these two men. Two men who had been given the presence of God in a remarkable understanding. And again, the Father came, enveloped them in clouds, overwhelmed the disciples. They stick their head in the ground, and the Father said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Then three little words that were for us. Listen to me. When the Father spoke those words, Moses and Elijah disappeared. The cloud disappeared. The Father went back into heaven. And Jesus comes over to these brave three men, and he touches them on their shoulders and says, stand up, follow me. We see a contrast. Now, Peter, James, and John had walked with the Lord almost 3 years at this time, and we look at Peter. You know, Peter's a guy who gives me a great deal of hope as a sinner. What a dink. He
He sees Moses, Elijah, and the Lord, and he goes, "Can I build three tents?" Three tents? He was out of his head. He had no idea what was going on. Everything he was watching right in front of him, he had no clue. He had no clue of what was really taking place. And it's really interesting that when he started to speak in Babel about three tents, the father interrupted him and said, "This is what..." So he shut him up really quick. What a demonstration was that there is only one who would ever come into the world who is both God and man. Only one who could take that which was physical and make it spiritual. Only one who could go to a cross and take an instrument of death and make it life. Everything that the Lord has done is to demonstrate what it is for us to be given His grace. And to give an impression upon His church to do one very special thing. It's called listen to Him. When He instituted the Lord's Supper, He had completed the Passover. It was why they celebrated it. It was no longer needed. John the Baptist had completed his work. He was, in the symbolic reality of life, the Elijah to come. He had fulfilled the same purpose that Elijah had fulfilled. He had come to ask people to repent. And now the Lord held the last Passover celebration. And at the end of it, after they had spent 3 hours going through everything that the Father in heaven had done for the people of Israel, and they ate everything that they were supposed to eat, and they spent this whole long time, then the Lord says, "But we have one more thing. I want you to use that cup of redemption." And then the Lord did what only the Lord could do. It's something that I said, I get very frustrated because I think maybe I'm really not very smart at all because I can't seem to make this simple enough. But I'm going to try one more thing. When the one who gave to us his means of grace, there were only two. Baptism of the Lord's Son. The one who gave him to us was both God and man. He gave to us something physical so that he could bring to us something spiritual. And the only one who could do that is if he was God and man. So Jesus, in his position as the messianic, the one who was promised, the one who came in the midst of his people, God walking in their midst, offered to them two remarkable gifts. First, baptism. Where he said, when you take a little water and you apply it to the child, you're not giving him a bath on his head. I am transforming a heart by my spirit, by my decree, so the water becomes life-giving. It's just water. But not in the blessing of our Lord. He took something physical. And he applied this spiritual to bring a blessing, this remarkable grace into the life of our children. We who are old, we who are young. Then he gave us this remarkable thing called the Lord's Supper. He held before his disciples this special loaf that he had taken out, that had been wrapped up in this special linen that represented the future. The future resurrection of the Messiah. And he took that bread out and he held it before his disciples and he broke it because it was a loaf. It was a flat loaf. It was no better than what we eat up here. It was unleavened bread. It was not tasty. It was not extraordinary. It was just a piece of bread. He broke it and he said, "This is my body, given for you for the forgiveness of sin." Then he took that third cup, that cup of redemption, and he held it before his disciples, and he said, "This is my blood. It's a new covenant given to you for the cleansing of your sin." The God who was man gave to his disciples what only a God-man could do. He gave them these physical to bring upon them
this reality of the spiritual, so that the bread and wine were his body and blood. Because he was both God and man. Only God could do this. That is why the Lord's Supper is such a remarkable thing. It is God coming into our presence. It is God giving to us a God gift of his grace. His means, his way, his chosen path. Which points us back to the Transfiguration. Nobody goes into a mountain and starts glowing. Glowing so brightly that people can't even look at them. No one goes into a mountain and all of a sudden clouds come and you have this voice start speaking. This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. No one goes into a mountain and all of a sudden Moses and Elijah come up and say, hey, how you doing? This was God in our midst. Christ showing the holiness that he was in possession of, but that was held down so that he could serve his Father and walk to a cross and die. The Transfiguration is a time when we are reminded that he was God and man. God in our midst to bring us his means by which he wanted to grant to us this remarkable thing called forgiveness and his mercy and his blessing and his spiritual strength. And so he granted us two remarkable gifts. Two remarkable gifts from his hand to ours that are both physical and divine. That's why he said, the Father said, listen to him. Because it isn't logical. It is divine. We need to trust in what he says, not what we see. I have watched for years now, 30 years, I've watched my confirmants after they confirmed received communion for the first time. And all of them make an effort to get it. They take the bread and I see that reaction because of it is kind of tasteless and not that good. But then they taste this wine that we use. And they make the most unique of face I could ever imagine. Because the supper isn't about goodness of taste. It's about promise of divine grace. That's what the Transfiguration reminds us of. The promise of divine grace. All the aspects of it are overwhelming to me. I have no answer. The scriptures don't explain it to us. We don't have an explanation of everything. People have thrown all kinds of things at it. It may be. But the truth is, it is of the promise of divine grace. Shown to us by the Father when he said, listen to him. It was his Son. It was the messianic promise of truth. It is why, before we start Lent, we have this day when we are reminded of just what our Lord revealed, so that we can understand the remarkableness of what he accomplished. May God hold us close to him, and may we always rejoice in the wonder of our God has been so willing to do on our behalf. Amen. Would you please rise?
Thank you.
And as your people, we are privileged to turn to you this day once again in the prayer that your Son has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Make us see. Heavenly Father, you grant us goodness you have showered upon us, and reflect your love in how we reach out to others. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Thank you.